It's the year 1600. The Western Spanish Empire reaches from Florida, around most of South America, and up the west coast of North America. Spain is a global superpower, and much of that power relies on the wealth and prosperity of its colonies. Peru is one such colony. Peru's coast is a narrow strip of land between the Pacific Ocean and the Andes mountain range. The Andes are home to many volcanoes. On the 17th of February, 1600, a mountain that no one had previously suspected suddenly roared to life in the second largest volcanic eruption in South American history. This eruption at Huaynaputina was truly colossal, reaching a volcanic explosivity index rating of 6, meaning that more than 10 cubic kilometers of material was ejected over the 18-day eruption. Surviving accounts of the eruption tell a tale of the apocalypse. The sky was black as night for days on end. Ash and fire fell from the heavens. Explosions like cannon shots terrified people, while tremors threatened to shake their homes down around them. The sketch here shows the scene at the city of Arequipa. In 1600, plate tectonics was unknown. The Peruvians, Spanish and Indians alike, could only understand what was happening to their world as divine fury. They sought desperately to appease their respective gods with rituals, which in some cases even extended to human sacrifice. Through the modern theory of plate tectonics, we know today that the volcanoes along western South America are driven by the subduction of the Nazca oceanic plate into the mantle. As the plate sinks, water and other volatile molecules are driven out by the rising temperatures, helping to melt some of the mantle, which then rises towards the surface as magma. This rising magma creates increasing pressure against the overhead rocks until they are broken, releasing the magma as a volcanic eruption. Here, looking westwards over Huaynaputina towards the Pacific, we can see the area of southern Peru affected most by the eruption. The cities of Moquegua and Arequipa are visible on the left and right. The areas hardest hit were those closest to the volcano. Pyroclastic flows rushed down the sides of the mountain, devastating everything they met. Afterwards, only exposed rooftops marked some sites where entire villages were buried. Modern estimates indicate that between 1,000 and 1,500 people lost their lives to Huaynaputina, but the true number remains unknowable. As the pyroclastic flows reached the Rio Tambo, the river boiled, leaving piles of cooked fish along its banks. Ash fell into the rivers and streams, triggering volcanic mud flows known as lahars. The lahar that swept down the Rio Tambo reached the Pacific Ocean 120 kilometers away. Ash continued to fall over the countryside. Up to 1 meter fell as far away as Moquegua and Arequipa, 80 kilometers from the crater. Around 1 foot of ash fell in Arequipa in the first day alone. Damage to buildings and farms throughout the region was severe. The local economy was so badly damaged that it took nearly 150 years for things to recover to pre-1600 levels. Ashfall continued to spread, and up to a centimeter was recorded at the capital of Lima, 800 kilometers distant. However, Huaynaputina's reach extended even beyond this. A tremendous amount of released dust and gas circled the entire globe. The Earth had already been in a cooling trend leading up to Huaynaputina's eruption. The added dust and gas in the atmosphere contributed to the famed winter of 1601, one of the coldest in the preceding 500 years. Agricultural production fell short that year, and major famines struck as far away as Russia. Few eruptions achieve VEI 6 size. The Mount St. Helens eruption of 1980 was only a VEI 5. To find a VEI 6 eruption in living memory, we must look to Mount Pinatubo's 1991 eruption in the Philippines. A photo of that eruption seen here shows a landscape devastated by heat and ash. Even so, measurements of ejecta from Pinatubo show that it was still smaller than Huaynaputina. Huaynaputina today can be found atop a high plateau in the Andes and is marked by its smallish crater and the remnant ash field around it. A casual inspection might fail to notice this giant now sleeping. Survivors of the 1600 eruption would caution us to remember, however, sleeping giants can wake up. Thank you for watching.